Welcome back to the second part of the human vs robot mastering video on my channel. And this is the original video, which is the ignition video for my response video. And this you can find on realhomerecording.com YouTube channel. If you didn't subscribe to this channel, please do it, because he's a really great guy and he shared a lot of useful information about home recording, home producing, home mastering. It's a pretty awesome collection what he is doing. And of course, I already subscribed to his channel from almost from the beginning. So here I ask from his subscribers, if somebody have a song what he wants to be mastered, he can send it to me, and then we will do a comparison between the lander.com and between the human mastered song. And one of his subscribers, fortunately, he said he have a song. So later on, I explained to him what I need. It's simple, like, please prepare your song on the highest quality what you can produce. It has to be a stereo mix, and please do not use any master compressor or EQ on this mix. And I need a simple dry mix with around minus 4 dB headroom. And I also, here you can see, it's really important, I here asked a reference song. So then later on I get from him the song, and now I will show you which kind of gears I will use for this mastering challenge. First, of course, I have a workstation over there, which is sending the digital signal to this Tascam mixer. And in this Tascam mixer, I have a possibility to do a direct routing from the digital inputs. Here you can see the signal which is coming from my computer. It's routed immediately to the digital output. So any kind of inside effects or bus or compressor or EQ or whatever will be not affect this signal at all. But for safety and for quick ideas, I always keep these two channel as a normal mixed channel. So from that, I always can send the signal back to the channel strip. And from the channel strip, I can get the signal on analog output, which is routed to my monitor switcher. And on that way, I always can do slight adjustment on a new ideas if I just want to find some problematic frequencies, or I want to play a bit with not multiband compressor. Of course, here I can do really easily and really quickly. And then after, I can see here in this display what's the actual settings what I applied here. And then, of course, I can copy these frequencies and these cues to my DBX Quantum II. So the main processor here in this mastering challenge will be this DBX Quantum II mastering processor. And I find one preset which is really close to this music, as I heard. And of course, I did some kind of modification on that, but I always just load up some kind of quick preset, and then from this preset I start to do a modification. The second tool, I have Alesis MasterLink recorder, and both of these devices is running on 96K 24-bit, but between the DBX Quantum II and between the Alesis MasterLink recorder, I use an analog cable, because I also have some kind of secret device. Maybe there you can see just the link cable. So now I also testing one of my secret device, which is under development and you cannot see because it's behind the table. And on that purpose, I used the analog output. The second purpose of using analog output from the DBX is this two potty, because the output is really clean and really nice sounding on an analog way, and here I also have a possibility to drive a bit more the input of the MasterLink recorder. And the MasterLink recorder, it also has a really nice analog to digital converter, and of course all the finalizing on a mastering will be happened inside in this MasterLink recorder, because this MasterLink recorder, it has a CD Redbook specialized the DSP chip, which is reformat all of your sound which is coming into this MasterLink recorder to the Redbook CD format. So from that MasterLink recorder, I can be sure the sound which is coming out from that is absolutely 100% right on a CD format. And later on, from that I will write out to the CD, and this is what I will transfer to this guy. And the next gear what I will use is this Yamaha SPX 2000 reverb engine. I know everybody is Lexicon fan and TC Electronic fan on a mastering. If somebody has to apply some kind of small reverb, it's almost everybody is using a TC Electronic 6000 series reverb engine or Lexicon. You see, I also have a Lexicon effect processor, but somehow I find this SPX 2000 reverb engine, it sounds really great and nice, because there is some kind of presets inside which is running on this new RevX engine. You will see later on what this mean, but I'm telling you guys, this SPX 2000 reverb engine, it's amazing natural sounding, and it has a really huge and nice space on a reverb if you apply on your final mix. We almost never use reverb on the mastering, but this song somehow it's a bit dry. You will see how and why I have to use a kind of reverb engine on a mastering. Okay, and there is no mastering without monitoring and controlling the monitoring. For that purpose, I have here this Behringer Xenix monitor control desk station, or I don't know how it's called. I like this unit because it's so cheap. And I'm telling you guys, no one of monitor controllers can survive more than 2 years of using, because we always turn and switch the things. So it doesn't matter if you spend €200 or €600. So for that purpose, I choose this Behringer monitor control, and this also give me a nice possibility to attach another computer to it by USB, and on this other computer I can check the frequency responses what is coming out on a main master output. I know this is a bit ogy-bogy, but who cares? Anyway, this box is not a part of the mastered signal, so everything is happening between my computer, between this reverb engine, between my secret device, and between this DBX Quantum II and the mastering recorder. So this one is just to listen back what I'm doing on a mastering, and for that purpose it's clean enough, and it's quick enough, and it's response enough to do this kind of really basic switchers. So from that switches, I have of course a Yamaha NS10M, but from the X series, and I have some kind of newer version of Yamaha speaker, and here I have a kind of crappy speaker what I always use for the mastering, because you know guys, in a mastering you have to check back your mixes on almost any kind of speakers, and for that purpose I have these three, and of course I have a fourth one which is sitting in my electronic lab, and I have a fifth one which is sitting on my home cinema system, and I have a sixth one which is sitting here on the guest room. So each of these speakers, it's a good speakers, but each one has a different size, different purpose, different dynamic range, different frequency response and whatever. I have, of course, some kind of amplifiers here. What you can see, this is these two active amplifier, and then I have a EQ corrector just for the Yamaha NS10. Also, we use two headphones. One headphone is closed headphone, but the other is opened. And I really like these two headphones. This is the Beyer Dynamic DT880 Pro headphone. I really like it. And this Behringer monitor controller really can drive really nicely and easily. And the next one is this HD25 from the Sennheiser. I really like this headphone. It's like amazing. It's I don't want to do a review now on that, but I'm telling you guys, this is a really great headphone for a monitoring and for do a low mid and low frequency checking on your mixes. Let me show you just a couple of issues. It's not a heavy dramas anyway. So the first issue, what I find in this specific song, is he has some kind of sampling issue in one of his instruments. So let me show you. Here you can see. So his one of his percussion sample is starting with a heavy big sampling issue. This he must be fixed in his system. So let me show you. It's almost consistent almost everywhere. You see here, this is the second one, and if I go forward, here you also can see this issue, and so it's almost constant to the whole of the song. What's the problem with this kind of sampling issues? Here on a frequency spectrum, you can see this heavy spike is generating all the harmonics in the whole hearable spectrum. So this he must be fixed. The second issue what I find with this song, all the percussion sounds, it's a bit dry. Anyway, this part is not a too loud part in the whole song, but here you easily can pick up. By the way, this is what the normal mastering engineers are doing. They're always sending back to you after the first checking where you can easily pick up the issue, because can be your monitors cannot translate these issues to you. So I also said to him, he can easily pick up this issue around 2 minutes 55. So let's listen. So if you listen this ta-ta-ta, it's really dry. Let me show you together with some kind of vocal. It's here, I think, somewhere. Let me show you other really interesting weird issue with this song. There is some kind of high frequency synthesizer carpet kind of sound which is running under the whole song almost, and somehow this synthesizer sound, it's bouncing from the left to the right. And here you can see when it's bounced from the left to the right side is always much more powerful and much more heavier. So let me show you this issue here, and then I will explain to you why we cannot fix it this. So when here it's coming to the right side, it's almost almost double power like the vocal. So our vocal is sitting somewhere here, but this heavy high frequency carpet is much more louder than these frequency ranges here. Let you again listen. Why we cannot fix that? Because it's really bouncing from the left to the right, from the left to the right, from the left to the right. And if you want to fix this kind of issue, you have to apply a lot of automation in EQing, in a dynamic processing and whatever. So it's much more easier also for the client to do a remix again and compensate this kind of error. On the end, of course, I asked the client to do a remix. So this is what I get from him as a second version. So let's first check this this sampling issue, which is somewhere here. And we still have this issue. But if you see the amount, it's a bit less than the beginning. So I don't know, there is two ways how to fix it. One is again ask the client to fix it, or maybe if he cannot, it's really deep somewhere in one of his samplers, so maybe he cannot fix that. So my idea with that just came one by one, like this, and fix it with a simple volume adjustment. Okay, so now it's much more cleaner, maybe. Yeah, at least we get more low harmonics. Okay, much more nicer. And now you can see the frequency spectrum of this percussion sound, because this is kind of percussion sounds. Just let me show you just this area and switch off the loop. Okay, so I have to go one by one and I have to fix this sampling issue. And the next issue, if you remember, we have this high frequency carpet almost the whole the songs. Now, if you watch the frequency spectrum, this bumpy, it's disappeared. There is, because the instrument is still there, but it's much more smoother, and you can see it almost exists on a two channel in the same time. So it's now, I think it's pushed to the mono field, and it's pushed back a bit to make sure the vocal has enough space and power in the song. So let me jump to here, for example. So yeah, he fixed at least the first main biggest issue with this song. Let me do some kind of analysis with this song. I already did the whole mastering and everything. I just want to show you guys what's going on here and how I did. First, I noticed if I listened on my Yamaha NS10 monitors, this song somehow around 4.4K, it has some kind of whistle noise, or I don't know what kind of noise is it. And maybe here you can see with these lines, but somehow even after this instrument here, it's end, but you see this 4.4K ringing is continue along the whole song almost. It's a really heavy for my ears to listen this 4.4 kilohertz signal almost on a whole song. Maybe you can see here, da 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 da, something like this. If I'm doing a visual analysis on this song, I also can pick up this 4.4 something. Just let me show it. On a Yamaha NS10 monitors, it's like, I'm telling you guys, it's like somebody whistling into my speakers. And So this is what the great about Yamaha NSTM. If something wrong with your song exactly in this middle area, these Yamaha NSTMs will scream into your face, and yeah, you will feel like, I am in a hell. So because of that, of course, I have to apply some kind of really narrow filtering on that frequency. And why I apply here in this software, because I don't want to lose one band in my mastering device, which is the Quantum II from the DBX. I don't want to lose just one full band just to compensate this. So here in the software nowadays, it's much more easier to do, and even the EQing on a computers nowadays, you can do a really narrow and clean filtering. Maybe you already picked up the next issue. The target media will be CD, and if you see the frequency spectrum, you see already we have a lot of high frequency content in this song. So what's the wrong about this? If you do a mastering for LP, for example, you don't have to worry about this, because the LP, if you believe or not, the LP can play back much more higher frequencies than the CD. So if you cut the LP from that material, you don't have to worry, you will get some kind of frequency response like this, but your high frequencies is will be sitting on a right position and in a right frequency. So it will be not to modulate the whole spectrum. With the CD, there is an issue. The CD is running on 44.1 kHz, so everything which is after the half of the maximum sampling rate, which is 22 kHz, everything which is coming after, it can generate for you a kind of subharmonics on a high frequency area. So later on, maybe I will do some kind of visualization video about it, how it's happening, but this is coming from the aliasing from the 44.1 kHz sampling rate. So we also have to filter it down really nicely. And what I realized immediately, maybe even you can hear it here on a YouTube. So if I apply this parametric EQ with this low-pass filter, let me show you what I did. Even if I do a cut on a high end, the whole mix will become much more cleaner on the high frequencies. Let me show you. Play. No margarita, cascozine, no cascine, mashallah. If you listen carefully, even by the YouTube, cross the YouTube, you can hear these high frequencies. It's much more cleaner than before. Let me play again. So yeah, it's cleaned out a lot of subharmonics, what else? So this is my 4.477 kilohertz cut. It's just a really, really narrow, as you can see, and it's only applied a minus 8 dB cutting to eliminate this kind of pike issue. If you believe or not, this is the all EQing what I do on a computer. It's really just a really basic filtering. So now let's jump to the next issue. I find this song somehow get from, I think from one of his recorder or cable or preamplifier, I don't know, a 60 hertz hum noise. And this I picked up from my subwoofer, because I'm now in Europe. So in Europe, in Germany, we are using a 50 hertz system. And I just heard a really tiny bit of modulated, really ugly 60 hertz, which is modulated by over 50 hertz, and it's do something like this if I turned up the volume on my subwoofer. So let me show you if this 60 hertz you can pick up easily. And the problem with this hum noises, it's not only 60 hertz. It will contain the 60 hertz, the 120, and so on, and so on, and so on, all the harmonics. By the way, this is a really low noise, so don't be confused, because it's already on minus 90 dB or something like this. But this small tiny bit of low frequency noise can affect your subharmonic synthesis or the low frequency equalization in the mastering. So let me again just play as a loop. Here you can see exactly 60 hertz. So go now to the 120. Here you see it's again like jumping modulation, and then 240. This you can see. So the energy level from this low frequency noise, it can affect your sub-bass processing. So to clear that is this dehummer. And the dehummer, what is doing? You have to select the frequency, which is in this song is 60 hertz. And then you have to apply a really narrow filtering, and you have to adjust the gain. Maybe this is also too much, I think, like something like this. And the number of the harmonics what you have to fix. Okay, it's not affecting too much the whole song, and don't forget this song is still not mastered. It's just kind of preparation for a mastering. So how I can check this dehumming, how it's working? Here on the beginning of the song, maybe here you can see, if I zoom in a bit, maybe even across the YouTube, you can hear it has some kind of really sub noise inside. And if we did a good job with the dehummer, then of course this sub has to be here. Yeah, it's somewhere here. So fortunately it's working really well. And the next issue what I find in this song is kind of a phase issue on the really low frequencies, like maximum up to 150 hertz or something like this. I think he applied some kind of chorus or delay or something, what he forgot to listen back or control back. To fix that, it's here in this software I almost cannot do, but the really basic what I can do is just to do a tiny bit of adjustment on the mid-side mixing, so get a bit more on a really low end. And here you can see choose this really low frequencies from 20 hertz to 120 hertz, and this is doing like it's also somehow smooths out the phase issues on a low frequencies. So let me show you to switch it on. Just listen carefully from here to here. So here in woo, there is some kind of sub inside, which is now it's really nice, and it's in some kind of controlled space. So again, listen back. It's something like this, and even I can hear and feel from my Sennheiser HD25. This is why I like this headphone, because it's a closed headphone and it's doing a really great job on a low, mid and a low frequencies if you want to do a monitoring. Next one. This will be much more complicated than you think. Of course, I asked from him a reference song. Okay, this is a really great song, what he chose as a reference song. I really like it. It's full with energy. It's, of course, there is a lot of really nice girls inside. And look, 16 million visitor. So it's meaning this song, it's really great and nicely mixed and mastered. So let me jump into the song somewhere, doesn't matter, to here, for example. And to here. Exactly here, what we are looking for. There is much more higher blood pressure in this song if you compare to his song. This song is not exactly this energy level. So no, don't listen to the frequency spectrum and it's not mastered anyway, but the drums and the loops and the percussions, it's far away from the reference song. So what is meaning for me, I just have to follow the tonality of this song, and I have to listen this song on a really interesting way. So I have to listen not on a musical way, but like a spectrum analyzer. I cannot explain to you guys deeply. Just let me jump here more, something like this. Yeah, this girl is, she's beautiful. Let me show you. Wow, she is beautiful. Classic mistake in a love. Classic mistake. Oh, wow. Opa, she is really beautiful. So, that's all from the reference song. And if you compare this to this song, yeah, I have to work like a frequency analyzer. So, I have to forget the energy level of this song. But if you believe or not, later on we exchanged again some kind of email about the energy and the style of this song. I realized this guy, he's a kind of live DJ mixer, or I don't know. So he has a lot of live gigs in a weekend. So this song will be run together with some kind of other disc or MP3 by his DJ gear. So it's meaning it will have a lot of energy, but not here. It will be mixed in a live set. So it's more interesting, this mastering, than first how I think. So luckily I have some kind of kick drum under it, but this kick drum is really just existing in every 4 beat or something like this. Just listen carefully. Okay, so on a kick drum and on a really low end, I have to do a kind of normal mastering. But on everything which is in the middle and everything which is on a high end, the song is still too dry. So let me show you where I think it's really too dry. Here you can see the vocal is really nicely affected, and it has some kind of multi-tap delay, and it's bouncing a bit, and it's a really well balanced on a mid range. So if you listen now, like, we don't wanna see nobody standing around. So it's not too harsh, not too over-emphased or something like this. It's a really clean tonality vocal with some kind of really nice effect. And but somehow in the song, the other parts, it's not a part of the space. Let me show you this issue. So I have a feeling like somebody play a vocal from a really nice high-end CD player, And then on a background, somebody play with some kind of sampler or drum machine or something. So this is my overall impression. To fix that, we have to apply a really unusual thing in a mastering. This is the last thing what we touch in a mastering even, and this is the reverb. So in a mastering we almost never apply some kind of reverb, but I'm really lucky because I have this Yamaha SPX 2000 reverb engine, which is running this Revex reverb system. So the great thing about this Revex engine, it's really nice sounding reverb, and it's hardware based. Don't forget, now everything is running through the Yamaha SPX 2000, and here I did a bypass, of course. For find the best sounding reverb, we always do like go to the 100, we fine adjust all these things, we listen back on a monitor speakers, and then when we arrive to some kind of really nice and good configuration, then we come back from the 100 to the point where we have some kind of sweet point. So let me play now the song with and without reverb. And it will also fix some kind of positioning issue with the vocal, because even this vocal is really nicely recorded and affected. But I have a feeling like this vocal is too heavy compared to the whole song. It's not meaning it's louder, I just have a feeling like it's too heavy and this is somehow in my face, so it's not on the right position on the on a sound stage. Pack. So this is only the reverb content of the mid-side mixing back, because I configured to stereo, mid and side and blah blah blah. There is a lot of deep setting in this SPX 2000. So now if I'm going back from this 100% to somewhere. We know why. Okay. Wanna see my people living up the place. Okay, and I think this is still too much. Tell the DJ to bring that fire. Boom, boom, of course this is zero. Tell the DJ to make it louder. Boom, boom, tell the DJ to make them boom, boom, dance. But here, if now you can listen. When I stop the music, I have a really tiny bit of after reverb, which is almost like it's not exist, but it's and a really tiny bit of taste to the whole mix. So let me go to this problematic dry area. It's here, I think. So let's play it. Bypass. Wait. Bypass. Back. Okay, so if you listen carefully, maybe you cannot hear it by YouTube, but here with Yamaha stems, I'm telling you guys, it's a huge difference between the two mix. Even I think I have to modify this a bit more, because the human ear, it's a really interesting measurement unit, and to compensate this issue I have to arrive around 30 milliseconds, because this is the time limit what your ear can define like delay. So I don't want to go deeply now inside, but I keep this under that. But this first bouncing delay, it will give me like a more feeling like the whole song is in some kind of space, but I'm still not here. This delay, maybe I think it's like this, it's much more better. Okay, so now if you listen, when I stop, it's not finishing like a knife knot, it's finishing like a really tiny bit of space noise. Yeah, and this Yamaha NS2000, I'm telling you guys, it's a really nice sounding reverb engine. So I think with the reverb we arrived to the right position. Maybe if I add a bit more to the high ends. Yeah, nice. Very nice. Very nice. Let me check here on the beginning, because if you remember, we have here some kind of sub blah blah blah. Okay, it's still unaffected. Here on a busy part. Maybe we have to increase a bit the time like this. Very nice. Okay. Okay, it's not modified too much the original song, but the space and the stage, it's came much more. So now I start to lose this feeling like the vocal is played somewhere else, and you know guys what I'm talking about. And now the vocal is also tricked my ears, so I can feel like the vocal, it's came back to the right size. I'm not talking about dynamic and volume, it's about somehow the size. So okay, for the better understanding, I did for you guys here some kind of visual representation about what is the most common issues with the vocals. So here I have a really nice stage where one of my favorite singer will be stay here and will be sing. So on the sound stage, of course, you have a left and a right side, and this don't has to be absolutely positioned here and to here, because this also gives some kind of unrealistic sound field feeling in your brain. So let me explain to you what is the best position for the vocalist. The vocalist, it has to be stay somewhere in a sound field and in a sound stage, somewhere part of everything which is happening. This is how it looks before we fixed this vocal with this kind of reverb trick. So here is my favorite singer, Eric Cartman. So this is the original situation with this specific song. In most of the case, almost all the time, the vocals are always too weak. So let me show you the weak vocal. So the weak vocal, it has enough power, but somehow it's still weak, and the whole frequency representation in a whole mix, it make the vocal so dry and weak somewhere in the middle. And the problem with that, if you listen on different devices, of course the most sensitive frequency region is the middle, And if you listen on different devices, different speakers, different headphones, of course, the first thing what will be affected by the differences, it will be the vocal. So if it's too mushy, too compressed, overcompressed, and unbalanced, so if you apply too much processing on a vocal, of course, you can easily arrive to some kind of situation like you see now. And this is what's happening when you overcompress. So some parts of the vocal will be disappeared. Some parts of the vocal will be much more louder than the whole vocal. So please never do overcompressing on a vocal. Try to keep the natural sound of the vocal if you can, or if your style it's allow you to do that. And when you over equalize the vocal, of course you start to lose a details in a vocal, so all the low frequencies will be dark and all the high frequencies will be really like something like this, and you lose informations about the whole frequency of the vocal. So this is what can happen when you over-equalize your vocal. And if you apply too much effect on a vocal, for example, too much chorus, too much delay, too much reverb or something, then you will arrive to something like this. So, because the human brain and the human ear cannot concentrate on the words. This is nowadays I heard many times this kind of issue in radios. I'm telling you guys, nowadays, I don't know who and why, they are doing really over-affected vocals in the songs. It's everything sounds like some robot came from the future and start to sing here. So please avoid from this kind of over-affected vocals. And then the other issue what you have to worry about if you do too much side mixing from your vocal. So what is mean? You apply some kind of delay on it and you pend the delay or your reverb to too wide. So let me explain to you. Pack, this is what can be happen. So even if your strongest vocal is sitting on the right position with the right side, then of course you have some kind of ghost vocalist. So the right vocal mixed, it's this one. So meaning we know Eric Cartman size. This is his natural size, so not like what we got on the beginning. And he's sitting in exactly in the middle. He's sitting in the right position in a sound stage, so it's not too far, it's not too front, it's not too big and not too small. And it's it has a really nice, clean tonality. If you have two bad gears and wrong converters, or you apply too much effects on a whole song, of course you will arrive to the noisy song. So even if your vocal is sitting in the right position, in the right place, in the right dynamics, then of course the whole mix is over-emphased and over-affected, and of course all of your noise level will be much more higher, and this will be fade out the whole song. I hope with this small visual representation with one of my best singer, with Eric Cartman, you can understand the basics, the basics of the mixing, positioning about your vocal, and how much amount of effects you can apply on a vocal without disturbing the listener. Let me show you again this part. So now the vocal is not too heavy, not too tight, not too big, not too compressed, whatever. And don't forget, we still not arrived to the final mastering. We still just on a preparation of the mastering. So let me jump now to the mastering. Of course, we will use the DBX Quantum II mastering processor with this song. Of course, we have to apply some kind of stereo widening on the song, because the reference song it's too wide. So for listen back on a hi-fi speakers and on PA speakers, it's too wide. So yeah, I know this is the reference song, but of course I will do from this song the best what I can do. I think with these four I'm happy. So let me listen back some nice part from the song without and with, and I just will really just switch on and off. So too much, too narrow. I think like this. Okay, next one. With the EQ, I chose. This is the next tricky place. I choose the formula in the DBX Quantum II to do a side mid EQing, because this song is not so wide and is not so busy. So we have to help a bit on the side equalization to get more balanced in a space. And don't forget, we applied a tiny bit of reverb on it, so we don't want too much side equalization on this song. So if you don't know what is mid-side compression and mid-side equalization, you have to look after it on a Google. So in this song, what kind of EQing I did? Of course, I find a lot of problematic frequencies, and when I did a comparison with the reference song, I did here in the mid EQ to came much more close together. So let me show you just the result, because I really don't want to spend a lot of time on EQing to show you everything what I already adjusted. So just let me play it, and so now the mid EQ is applied like this, but look at the side EQ. The side EQ, it has other kind of settings. And if you see that trick here, I did on a side EQ a lot of low cut and a tiny bit of cut in exactly where the vocal is sitting. And I applied a bit of emphasis on the high. So it's about 1 dB, not more. So what is do with this song? It will help me again a lot on a phasing issue on these low frequencies, and will be clear the space between the vocal and between the side of the sound stage. This high emphasis, it will be help a bit for the effects, for the delay, for the chorus, for the reverb to get a bit more clarity, just a tiny bit. If you see here, it's only 1 dB, not more. And it's really starting on a really high frequencies, on a 16K maybe. If I think it's still good. So let me listen back with the side and with the mid. Now it's much more closer to the reference song. Don't worry, if you hear now the song is weak and it's not really professionally mixed, don't worry, we still have a compressor, we still have a limiter, we still have a lot of stuff after it. But the basics with this song. I chose the pre-compression EQ with side mid. So let's now jump to the ambience. This Quantum II contain a really interesting dynamic section, which is working on the ambience sounds. It's a really weird signal processing, and on a first time when I start to use it, I even didn't hear what's going on. But with my Beyer Dynamic DT880 headphone, I start to pick up the real huge differences, even if I just touched these things a really tiny bit. So let me switch on and switch off this processing. So here, if I coming to this clean section, and we don't wanna see nobody on the wall. Wanna see my people live. And if you listen careful, the delayed, tab delayed vocal part, you can notice it's get a kind of much more smoother on a dynamic and on a compression. Hurry up, you know this. We don't wanna see nobody standing round. And we don't wanna see nobody. Just the delay and the chorus part of the vocal. Hurry up, you know this. We don't wanna see nobody standing round. And we don't wanna see nobody on the wall. Okay. Wanna see people living up the place. The first compressor will work on a low frequencies. The next one will be work on a low mid frequencies. The third compressor will be work on a vocal frequencies, and then the last compressor will be work only on a really high ends. And then because of that, you can apply different compression settings for different frequency ranges. If you want to know more about multiband compression, Google it, search on YouTube and learn why it's so important. With these settings, I 100% sure, and I listen back 100 times, know the crossover frequencies is exactly matching with the song. So, and also as a result, if I compared it to the reference song, this setting is really close to the reference song. And I don't want to lose the details of this tab delay. So if I apply a gate or any kind of gating on this song, I will lose a lot of detail on here on the bottom. So the gates I didn't switch on, of course, but the compressors. Let me switch on now all the compressor. Here you can see a lot of gain changes, and it has some kind of logarithmic shape. It's not by randomly. I played a lot with that, and I also have a different attack time. This is for the vocal, and I have a different thresholds for different frequencies, and I have a different ratios for everything. But what you can see here with the ratios, I never apply too much, too heavy compression on any frequency band, because it really can destroy the song. And nowadays there is some songs which is really over compressed, over limited, overdrive because of this stupid lewdness war. And I'm not a part of this game, so I apply just a really slightly bit of compression on every frequencies, because we still have a really nice digital limiter in the Quantum II processor, which will give us a full control on the output power with a really nice limiting. So, and soon, as you see, we almost already arrived to the output, which is meaning the song is done and mastered. We still have around 1.5 2 dB headroom on my DBX Quantum II, which is meaning I still can push the compressors a bit. So let's add a bit more gain to here, like 5 and a 5, like you know what, 4, 4, 5, and this is a really nice touch. Look, pack, pack, pack. So I can add to the whole frequencies together a same amount of gain. So let me play back again. And on a limiter. We have headroom of 1.5–2 dB still in the Quantum 2, and here I can give back this extra headroom to use and utilize as a space for the normalization. So, and of course I do some kind of soft normalization also. I don't wanna over compress and over normalize everything, just slightly achieve minus half dB on the CD. And yeah, so let's engage the normalization and listen bypassed first, and then of course I will switch to the processed signal. So no bypass and no engaged. No, everything is in the right position. It has a space. It's I think it's equalized really well and really close to the reference song. But of course, I can check this with some kind of other tool. Let me now listen back on a DT880 headphone and play. So now I listened enough with headphones and with different headphones, with small speakers and whatever. So now my ears and my brain needs to be rest a bit from this song, because of course if you listen the same song in 20 times, 100 times, of course your ears start to be get lazy and you didn't hear the details. So this is what I noticed here. I already started to adjust the compressors and the EQs just a bit, and I know this is the first sign my brain is start to be tired out from this song. So now we stop here, and of course I will continue the mastering of this song, because we still have some things to check it. For example, we will compare to the reference song, not just with my ears and with my monitors, also with some kind of scientific tool. Yeah, see you tomorrow.